So let's move on without any further due time to the second presentation from Charles van der Hagen. Now, Charles is a founder and the CEO of ZERI. ZERI is the Zero Emission Research and Initiatives company based in Brussels. And you know, Charles has had a long life working in the corporate world. And today, if you go on the ZERI site, I'll leave you with just two or three sentences that are interesting. The first one is, ZERI means use what you have. ZERI is inspired by the wisdom of nature. And you know, this sentence, I think, really resonates very much, at least to me. Nature doesn't know the concept of waste. The only species capable of making something no one desires is the human species. So on that note, you know, Charles, welcome. And you know, Charles will be talking to us about not the green economy, but the blue economy. So thank you, Charles.
Speaking after Yuri is quite a challenge. Thank you, organizers. I will start with a personal story. I have to take my thing here. Okay. I will start with a personal story, which is kind of financial in some sense. I floated a company in 1996. I floated it on the French Nouveau Marché. It was a very new thing, the Nouveau Marché in France. And it was because the shareholders that I had to at that time, I bought this company with partners, and these shareholders wanted absolutely to float this company. I saw my stock price raising and raising and raising. It was fantastic. It was really fun to see, if you like, you float and then you see your stock price float and increase and increase. So I was in a kind of virtual world, endless growth. What I didn't mention, I had a lot of road shows. I had a lot of work to do managing this company, and it was great. I bought some house with a big piece of land, and I started dreaming, you know, if this continues, I will get very rich, and I will end my days in my estate with horses and as a gentleman farmer. And what I didn't see is that the initial shareholders, they sold. They sold to other shareholders. The other shareholders sold. And the other shareholders sold. And they sold. And I didn't see that. I couldn't sell because I was a CEO. I had to carry this company. I had the task of keeping this endless growth of my share price going until the Nouveau Marché burst .com bubble. And so there I was. And my shareholders were all ordinary people. Pensioners who had been attracted in this trap by the banking system, because that's the name of the game. It's a Ponzi scheme, and I was trapped too, because if you like, I had negotiated very nice options, which I realized three years after the IPO, according to the rules, and I was very happy because the price at that time to pay for my shares was very, very interesting. It was probably 30% of the value of my share, so I made a great deal. But I had to borrow money for that. So I was bankrupt, or almost bankrupt. And all my assets went on to be sold and to reimburse the debts that I had made to acquire these option shares, which I thought was a beautiful thing. So that's my personal story on the financial market. And I remember the words of this Warren Buffett. And Warren Buffett says that I have to take my glasses because I am an old man. And Warren Buffett, he had this fantastic sentence. When a person with money meets a person with experience, the one with experience ends up with the money, and the one with money ends up leaving experience. So there I was. I had a lot of experience. I had no money anymore. I started without money, and I ended without money. And I thought, because when you are disrupted like that, I think it's a right moment to think through how stupid I had been, how blind I had been to see this thing happening, and this thing is happening every day still yet. So I share with you this personal experience, and I share with you learning by doing. I did it. I learned, and I think I learned a lot, and I recuperated what I had lost. I then went into deep trouble, deep depression, and I started doing a lot of things in order to save myself, save my family. I learned a lot, and I met an incredible guy who had met all these people and much more. And he was called Günter Pauli. And this Günter Pauli, I had known him for 35 years. And he asked me, we spoke regularly, and he spoke about what he was doing. And he was doing this Zeri thing. He started it in 94, when the United Nations University and the Japanese government asked him to help them prepare the Kyoto round of climate change in 97. So he got a fantastic budget, and he got a lot of researchers to travel the world round to see how can the world, if you like, avoid this climate change issue. And the choice of the Japanese and the United Nations at that time was not zero default or not zero quality or 100% quality, it was zero waste. And it was presented at the Kyoto Protocol, but obviously the thing was already decided by American and Europeans. It was trade, cap and trade, through the market, if you like, solve the problem through the market. Doing the same things over and again, expecting different results. You know this sentence from Einstein. And Günther told me that he was very disappointed by Europe, and that Europe, if you like, couldn't move because it was locked in, an institutional technological lock-in. And I said to him, listen, if Europe isn't part of the new world, I think it's a mistake. You have to be in Europe too. You are in America. You are in the South America, you are in the Eastern countries, China, India, Japan, and a lot of other countries. You are in Africa. Why not in Europe? And he said, because of this, and I have problems in Europe. I cannot really feel Europe. They don't move. And so I said, you have to try. And he said, well, I don't try, you try. And I joined him. And I joined him 5 years ago, and we started this fantastic venture of the Blue Economy to Zeri. The Blue Economy is Zeri in action. And action is for us much more important. You know, the Pennsylvania University, 5 years on a row, qualifies us as one of the 10 most innovative policy think tanks in the world. But we are not a think tank. We are a do tank. And combien de temps? How much time do I have? Still 22 minutes. Great. So the do tank, we published a book. Günter published a book. This book is The Blue Economy. It was published in 2009. It was reedited a few years ago, a few days ago in Italy. 40 languages translated, 1.5 million copies sold worldwide, and $4 billion invested in projects which generated 3 million jobs on 200 projects. So the Do Tank is, if you like, showing that projects can work, that the world can work with abundance, no waste, and that full employment can be reached when you just don't waste resources. I have two examples, very quickly, two examples to show you what we're busy with. The new agriculture and chemistry as a renewable basis for materials. That is cardoons. This is thistles in Sardinia. With thistles in Sardinia, we are manufacturing 7 different industrial products. Not with oil anymore, with thistles. The oil, if you like, what we did is buy this refinery, which was set up in Sardinia to process the oil coming from Gaddafi. And obviously, they had some problems of pricing after Gaddafi's death. And so this plant, 14,000 hectares, was totally idle, and it was kept in life just because the cost of closing it was just unbearable for the Italian government. Eni was the owner of this plant. So we helped Novamont, a company in biotechnology and biochemistry, buy this land together with Eni, 50-50. We invested $845 million in order to create a plant, which is a plant that can process these thistles instead of processing the oil. And now we are taking other, what we call stranded assets in chemistry in Italy. And there is no refinery anymore in Italy. The last one we bought was near Venice, and this plant will process all the algae that is, if you like, disturbing the boats around Venice in the Adriatic Sea. So Novamont is a fantastic example. It got, if you like, a very special treatment by the Juncker Fund. Katia Bastioli, which is the CEO and the founder of this company, has been named one of the brightest and most productive researchers in the world. She got a lot of prizes. I think it's a beautiful example of how, if you like, petroleum-based products can be substituted by products made out of renewable raw materials. And I think that's very important because it is obviously the future. The second example, I think, is I didn't hear it from my friend Yuri. It's Liffey. Who has heard of Liffey? He has heard of it, but he didn't speak of it. So I think it's a very important, because Liffey is, if you like, how can you create internet and how can you create communication with light? When you have a LED light, you have, in fact, once a second, you can have 10 million pulses a second. And each pulse, if you like, is a yes or no, but during the phase, if you like, you can get a lot of information in the way. So it's, you can download 18 DVDs in 1 second. And so you have, and you need infrastructure for that. There are 14 billion light poles on the streets. 90% of these light poles are mercury-based lights. Replace them with LED lights, and you have the most fantastic network of LiFi in the world, which can transfer information very quickly. You have a totally new application of how this LiFi works. So we had the internet. We had the internet 2.0. You had the internet 3.0, the internet 4.0, connecting everything. So now it's impossible to connect everything. There are 75 million objects that should be connected. We cannot do that with the bandwidth that is available with radio waves. But light waves is so much powerful that you can create, if you like, connections. And the connections is one of the key issues of the future, is connecting things with people and connecting people. And connecting it, if you like, in the world, because the world we go in is a world in connection. We are exposing totally new thinking. You can see that in the Pulse post that I have been issuing at the demand of the organizers here to explain a bit what is the scientific basis on which we work in order, if you like, to create the ideas that we have. So we can connect everything. We can connect everything productively and with a purpose. And the purpose is, so LiFi is, you need light, just light, and below the light you have, if you like, an area when you can download, and you can, if you like, you have a special application where you can also send, and so you create a network which is very, very powerful, and it opens up enormous opportunities in retail, in hospitals, in smart cities. It is secure because you cannot hack light. So you also help, if you like, this big thing, which is the security of the internet and of the Wi-Fi. You know that in every phone that you have, you are directly connected to the NASA and the NSA. And so you have to replace all these things with the LiFi technology, the LiFi chips. So we have a very, very big development going on, helping this company create, if you like, its future. It has a large advantage. It's a French company, and obviously it's a geopolitical issue, and a very big geopolitical issue that we are tackling right now. Not only that, but imagine Fukushima. You know that Fukushima, nobody has still been able to look inside of the reactor. Nobody. So you don't know where there are leaks, what is happening there. Nobody knows that, because there is no technology who, if you like, is powerful enough to go into these temperatures and see the things. With light, you can see it. So we are developing in special applications so that, if you like, in every nuclear reactor, you can go and see what's happening inside the reactor, that the reactor works or doesn't work. You can see in it. You can see, obviously, it in Three Mile Island, or you can see it in Fukushima or in another place, but you can also see it on the thousands of nuclear power stations that are today in the world, and you can gain information. You know, the Belgians, they don't know if they have to close their plants or they don't have to close their plants. They don't know because they cannot see inside it very well. But I wanted to say you that is technology, and that is technology applied, if you like, to change the world. But there is something that most people forget. There are two types of economies. There is the economy that everybody knows, which is the global economy, which is what it is, and which is very well documented and very well standardized, and the learning and education is standardized around the way this economy is organized. But there is another economy. And this other economy we call the microeconomy, the local economy. And Polytechnic of Torino, in their system design department, have done a lot of job to analyze what is micro and what is the potential of micro. And I think this is a fundamental thing, because I think if we want to change the world, if we want to show that another way of living together on this world is possible with abundance and collaboration, you can only show it, you can only do it by showing what happens. We show it in 200 places in the world, but they are too minor. People still don't believe it because it's not at the level of a region or at the level of a country. So we have to upscale these things. And with Politecnico, we are working hard, because I think the upscaling is by creating local economies which are interconnected with each other and which satisfy the basic needs of all the people, inclusive jobs, inclusive the potential to acquire, if you like, to grow to the highest potential in a region with what is locally available. Today, we have all the technologies that is necessary to ensure that the basic needs of every people everywhere in the world locally can be satisfied with what is locally available. That we've shown. But we have not shown it in the mainstream regions. Now we are working in Brittany, we are working in France, we are working in the Basque Country, we are working in Italy to show that. But it's not proven yet. University of Torino has at least conceptualized it and is working on transforming it. So Luigi Bistagnino has been in Luxembourg 2 years ago, 1 year ago, and he explained that to the University of Luxembourg. He made a show and he explained his technology, his idea, his realizations, his analysis. He had no answer. People don't believe him. And that's the problem of our times. People don't believe in something that they cannot touch. But innovation is just jumping into something that is unknown. And I think we have, and that was the problem of Günther, it's to convince Europeans to jump and to risk things and to risk doing things that has never been done before. So the Micro Macro book of Gino is just came out 14 days ago. And so it's the whole of micro systemic relations which are generated in the new, what he calls the new economic productive model, the local economic development. And there are a lot of cases in there. There are a lot of ideas in there. I really do advise you to buy this book. It's 9.99 euro for an ebook. It's 400 pages long. It's very, very interesting reading. For example, he shows that, if you like, in Italy, but also over all Europe, large and medium-sized companies, so companies above 50 people, are only 35% of the companies. They are only 0.6% of the companies in a region. They make only 35% of the revenues of a company, of a country, but the small and the micro companies have a much bigger share, and that is a forgotten world. So he concentrates on this forgotten world, on which we impose the systems of the global economy. It's impossible. It's two different systems with two different ways of organizing them and of having them work. And that is basically his idea. He shows in a region, and he worked with Deloitte, Deloitte Torino, by the way, to come up with the figures. So he looked at Val Sangone, which is a region in Italy, and he looked at what is happening today and what could happen if they would work systemically. And he sees that there were 192 activities which were, if you like, evaluated, which existed today. It could become 323 activities, so 70% more. that the number of employees that worked in those companies or these activities was 384 and could become 647, so that's 70% increase in employee. But EBT, earnings before tax, was only 500,000 and it could move to 4 million conservatively shadowed. And so he looked at all the opportunities, all the activities who were not there. And I think if we look at what exists and what doesn't exist, we have to look at what doesn't exist. You remember Sherlock Holmes and his guy, the dog that didn't bark. Well, I think you should look at the dog that didn't bark. And so activities who are lacking and who creates, if you like, this total or a quasi-total satisfaction of the needs of a territorial. And you see that you can move to a quasi 100% satisfaction with what is locally available in the country. Very interesting reading, I really appreciate. And so you have two systems. One system is our actual system, you see the fish. The other system is the birds who are going together. And it's all about collaboration, it's all about connections, and therefore connections is such a very important thing. I move on. But for example, we are working in the Flanders. Nobody knows that because we are working rhizomically under the ground. But in the Flanders we have proposed, they have a big problem. The problem is how to defend the sea coast of Belgium, 63 kilometers. Yeah, thank you very much. So le projet fou de Günther Pauli in the Flanders, faire reculer la mer à la côte belge. It's an impossible task. It requires 25 billion euros to do that. What is the... And so nobody has this money available. And so we worked on it, and we said, but this money is available, because it can generate a lot of economic development. And if you have economic development, you have the means to finance that. And so we have made a plan, which is a systemic plan. I show you how we work and how we show all the relations between everything. If you really look at what what such a defense of the coast can bring in fresh food, in energy, in all kinds of things, if you do it correctly, we calculated that it can, if you like, be reimbursed in 10 years' time. So this 25 billion is not a problem. It's not a problem because it is economic growth that you are generating in Flanders. Now, what is interesting is in Flanders is that the cathedrals in Flanders were built by the people, by the bourgeoisie in towns, not by the church, not by the prince. They were built by towns, by the people in the towns. And the people who financed the initial venture, they knew that they would never see the cathedral. And so we went to a number of very rich families in Flanders, and we asked them, do you want to participate in the renewal of Flanders, in the sustainability of Flanders? Do you want your second generation, your third generation, to still be proud of yourself, of your family, of what your family has done for its country? So 10 families accepted to put a lot of money, if you like, to make this plan, to study this plan, to implement this plan. And the government said, okay, we will put an equivalent amount. So we have money to at least do the engineering work, the design work, to do that all. And the finance we know, and we organize the finance in another way. We are working with 150 family offices, very family offices, but with the family, not with the intermediaries, with the families. We are working with the families in order to create, if you like, a pool of money that can, if you like, sustain the future on a very long term. And I think they will make a lot of money with it, but they will make a lot of impact also. And we work with them on the condition that they work with us. So not a real connection, a real tie. And I think the proof is that it works in Flanders. We are working on it in Brittany. We are working on it in Argentina. And it works. It works. You can find responsible families who really devote a small amount of their fortune to take risks. In fact, they don't take risks, but they can consider that they take risks. They take risks with, and they also build, if you like, the future, and they build the future of their country. We believe economy should enhance peaceful and dignified life for all in striving, flourishing communities, not the other way around. And the role of finance, I think, is helping this economy to do its job. And that is my conclusion on finance. If only finance would accept a purpose, which is a purpose to bring back, in fact, nature and the humans. We are part of nature, nature and the humans, back on our evolutionary course. If only we finance would help us doing that together with everybody in the communities, I think we would be very well off. The question is, what is the purpose? If you don't have the purpose right, you cannot have the solutions right. And so the solutions is obviously to also look at the monetary system. And we are looking at the monetary system. Many people are looking at the monetary system. We have to dare to look at the monetary system. And we have to design this monetary system to fulfill its role, its societal role. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Charles. I think we're going to take a first question from here, which is, what could be Luxembourg's position in this economy?
I have not the slightest idea. Yeah. Okay. I must honestly, when I come here, I see a kind of bubble. It's extraordinary. You have no problems. I think the fundamental change can only happen. Can only happen if people have real problems. I don't see problems here. Now, I think I'm obviously a bit dumb to say that. I think some people will see the problems that you may face in the future and problems that you have escaped in the past. But where are you coming from? Where are you heading to? And I think it's very important to see that. So what's the purpose of... And so let's also move away from fragmentation. So Luxembourg is part of a whole. And so what is the role Luxembourg can play in this whole? I think you have extraordinary resources. You have extraordinary possibilities. If you only would use your possibilities to enhance the whole world, I think we can avoid incredible nasty things, incredible geopolitical problems, incredible wars, incredible destruction. And I think it's the duty of every human being to work on that. And I think, I believe, Luxembourgers are also human beings, aren't they? So if only I can touch the human being in you, I'm very happy. And the human, and if only you can say that the way, if you like, you are being used in a system that is not working anymore, and that the systems should change, and that your responsibility vis-à-vis your children and vis-à-vis your future is, and vis-à-vis yourself, is to help change this system which enslaves you, well, then you can do something. It's an individual decision.
Okay. Any question from the audience? Anyone would like to ask a question? I have one for you, which is, you talked a lot about some of the projects and initiatives that are taking place in Europe, but how does Europe compare to the rest of the world? Would you say that Europe is behind, is ahead, and what can we do differently if we are behind?
We have never worked in the United States. In the beginning, we have worked a bit in the United States with great success in some areas, But we think the United States is not mature to really expose these ideas. We worked a lot in South America. We are, for example, advising the new president of Argentina. We are working with Argentina to create, if you like, a totally new economy for Argentina with great success. There was an article in the Financial Times that Macri got investor adherence, and that's very important because we are really working with them. But we are working also with people, very rich people in Argentina, who help us to do this transition. We are working in South Africa. We are working in Africa a great deal. We are working, obviously, in China a lot. We were working in India a lot. We are working in Indonesia a lot. So we are working overall in the world. And Europe, I think Europe has this unique chance. And with Macron, I must say, my hope was totally lost. I made a blog post on my personal blog at the beginning of the year, where I said best wishes, but what should I wish myself? What should I wish you? I don't know anymore. And I think it was a pessimistic thing, but also with hope. And I quoted Vaclav Havel with his definition of hope. I think with Macron, I think the hope has been substantiated. So is he the right guy? Can we help him becoming the right guy? I think that's my aim, and we are working a lot in France to make sure that France can fulfill the dreams that they have, if you like, they have created by electing Macron.
Charles, thank you
but
very
much. But we are working in Italy, we are working in Basque, where I said it, okay. Yeah, and sure. Now in Holland also.
Thank you very much, Charles. So,
I have an announcement.
You have an announcement to make? Oh, please go ahead.
I have an announcement. Two announcements. For people interested in what I said, perhaps 2% of the people, there is a guy in the room, and this guy in the room is called Xavier Delpossen. Xavier, where are you? I don't see it because
there,
I have
there.
All.
It's right there in the middle.
Okay. Xavier is, if you like, the guy who you can contact in first instance. I worked with him here on Luxembourg, and I worked with him to solve the trans-border problems that Luxembourg may have. And then I have an announcement that the organizers asked me to make. There is a... I have to take my glasses. There is a virtual reality booth that is available, I don't know where.
Where it's is virtual. It? It's virtual. So.
It's in the hall. In the hall. It's the Deloitte's corporate social responsibility team has identified virtual reality as a great tool to foster social impact and help NGOs. The concept started after finding out that the main challenge for NGOs is to find donors who will help them finance their activities on a regular basis. I think what virtual reality brings is that you have a special glasses and you see the world differently. And you see what can happen in the world if you give these NGOs the means to do the things. And I will come back to Edgar Morin, who explains that, if you like, there in the world, there are so many things happening, so many things on individual basis, in small teams, villages. Everybody is busy with something. And I'm sure that in the room, everybody is busy with something, in something towards, if you like, a renewal of society. And Edgar Morin says, if only we could connect all these individual things, connecting. If we could only connect them, we could make possible this invisible, still invisible, and totally improbable metamorphosis, which is in the is possible to happen unless catastrophes go come by.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you for your passion and enthusiasm.